We just discussed what the placebo effect was. Now let's talk about the psychological mechanisms that are involved, the most important of which is the role of expectancy, which I mentioned in the previous section. There are two types. One is conscious expectancy, usually following a verbal instruction. The other is conditioning, which could be either conscious or unconscious. So I want to talk about the power of verbal instruction. This is a group of patients who had a thoracotomy, open chest surgery. The postoperative pain following a thoracotomy is quite severe and is usually treated with opioids. In this case, to study the effect of verbal instruction, patients received an infusion of saline. They were told three different things. They were told they were either getting rehydration, which is no pain medication. Another group was told that they were part of a double-blind study where they could receive either morphine or saline in their infusion, and that was this group. Okay. And then the final group was told that they were going to get morphine, a powerful pain reliever. What these bars represent is the amount of rescue medication the patients required to control their pain. In this case, it was buprenorphine, which is an opioid. It's an effective analgesic. The more pain they experienced, the more buprenorphine they would request. So you can see that patients that were expecting no pain reliever in their infusion needed a lot of buprenorphine, as shown here. The group that thought they were in a double-blind study and might get pain reliever, they required an intermediate dose of buprenorphine, whereas those that were told they were getting a powerful pain reliever had very little need for rescue medication. So this tells you that this is the same type of pain. It's very severe, but the amount of pain relief that they got from suggestion depended very much on exactly what they were told. So let's move on to another way that you can do the same sort of study, but a different type of conditioning, a different type of expectation. In this case, these were normal volunteers, and they were undergoing tourniquet pain. With tourniquet pain, a blood pressure cuff was put on the arm. It was pumped up above the systolic pressure. Okay, so cutting off blood supply to the limb, and then they were told to exercise. Now, normally, after 10 to 15 minutes, it becomes very painful, and the subjects were told they should stop when they couldn't take the pain anymore. The average subject could last for about 15 minutes, that's shown here, with no treatment. The next day, they were brought back, the same blood pressure cuff. This time, they were told they were getting morphine through an intravenous line, and there might have been a little bit of a pain-relieving effect, but not much. On day three, they went back. They were told they weren't getting any pain reliever at all, and you can see that they're back where they were on day one. This other group, completely different. So on day one, there was no medication. On day two, they received a good dose of morphine, and you can see that their ability to tolerate pain was markedly increased. They did that again on day three. They could stand the pain for almost twice as long. Now, here's the critical experiment. On day four, they were given a saline infusion, okay? No morphine, which is the same as what they got over here, right? But after the two big doses of morphine, when they were told they were getting morphine, they got a much bigger pain-relieving effect. So clearly what happened was they had been conditioned to expect powerful pain relief. And that convinced them even more that what they were getting was an effective medication. So their expectation of relief was higher. So they got a very good relief. Not as good as morphine, but much better than the unconditioned suggestion of relief, which is shown over here. All right, so those are the two psychological factors that play a role in determining the effectiveness of expectation in the relief of pain. So what we've just discussed are the two major factors that play into expectation of pain relief, verbal instruction, and conditioning. What I'd like to switch to now is a discussion of the neural mechanisms that underlie this effect of expectation, i.e. the reduction of pain.